Good morning, or I guess afternoon, evening, depending on when you're watching this. And Merry Christmas. We're thrilled that you are joining us for our TSF pre-recorded Christmas celebration today. We're going to have some music as we worship through the music. We're going to have a time of reflection. We're going to be able to have a couple things for the kids as well as you go through this program. So I hope that it just helps your day as we just worship God together. Whether you be there yourself, or if you have a spouse, or if you have immediate family, extended family, that this is just a time that we can really celebrate Christ, the birth of Christ. So I pray that you just enjoy that as we go into it. Don't forget, for myself, from Jenny, from Emily, from Ryan, the grandbabies, even my dad, Merry Christmas, and we're thrilled to be able to share this time with you online. Be blessed.
Sunset, I sweep the snow from my doorstep. I just can't help but stop and grin. It's like I'm 10 years old again. And everywhere I go, I can feel it. Some say it moves like a spirit that falls on us once a year, like it came on a midnight clear. So love, this season is a gift. When love came down to Leslie, let's open up and let our hearts embrace this moment. For Christmas this year, we're gonna make a sound, gonna make it loud. For Christmas this year, we're gonna make some noise, let the world rejoice. For Christmas this year, for Christmas this year. The laughter starts before the sunrise. I sneak downstairs to sparkling eyes, and oh, what joy it brings to me. The family around our Christmas tree, and I thank the Lord for His favor as we sing the songs of the Savior.
Christmas didn't just happen by accident. It happened for a reason. And to understand that reason, we need to go back a long, long way. The Bible tells us that in the beginning, everything in the world was very good. God made people to be friends with Him and with each other. He put them in a beautiful garden with everything they needed. Sadly, things went wrong. The first people, Adam and Eve, decided they wanted to run their lives their own way, not God's way. They had to leave their garden paradise and soon God seemed far away, and the world was broken without God. But God still loved everybody and was very sad about what had happened. He decided to do something about it and chose a man called Abraham. God promised Abraham that through his children, he would help to fix the world. Over many years, Abraham's descendants became the Jewish people and lived in Israel, the land that God had given them. Time passed. God's people kept getting into trouble, but God always rescued them. He sent messengers to remind them who he was and to guide them back to him. In order to protect and lead his people, God gave them kings. The greatest and best of those kings was David, from a place called Bethlehem. In time, people built a big temple where they could be closer to God. But despite the messengers, the kings and the temple, God still seemed far away. God made many promises to his people that one day a special king would come who would bring God and people back together again. The Jewish people kept waiting for a child to be born who would be the promised king. Finally, 2,000 years ago, things began to happen. The first thing that happened was that an angel appeared to an old man called Zechariah who served in the temple. The angel told him that after a lifetime of waiting, his wife Elizabeth would have a baby son. This boy would be someone special. He would be filled with God's Holy Spirit and would prepare the way for God's king. The baby was to be called John. Later in the Bible, we read how John made people ready for God's king by baptizing them in water as a sign that their sins had been washed away and their lives were clean. But the really important thing was what happened at almost the same time in a town called Nazareth. A young girl called Mary lived there, and she loved God. Mary was engaged to be married to a man called Joseph. One day, she was visited by an angel called Gabriel. "Don't be afraid, Mary. God is pleased with you," Gabriel said. "You are going to become pregnant. The boy you will have will be called Jesus, and he will be great." The name Jesus means God rescues, and rescuing is exactly what Jesus does. "People will call Jesus the Son of God," Gabriel continued, "and he will be a king like David, only with a kingdom that will never end." Mary didn't understand. "There's a problem," she said. "You need a man to produce babies, and Joseph and I aren't yet married." Gabriel replied, "That isn't a problem for God. The baby will be made through God's Holy Spirit." This tells us that Jesus was not going to be an ordinary human being like you or me, but God as well. Mary bowed her head. "I am God's servant. May your promises come true." She was so filled with joy that she sang a song to God, praising him for what he was doing for his people. Joseph was not happy when he heard that the girl he was going to marry was pregnant. But he had a dream in which an angel spoke to him, telling him not to worry. Mary had done nothing wrong, and the baby who was coming had been made by the Holy Spirit. You might have expected that Mary would stay in Nazareth to have her baby, but God had other plans. At this time, Israel was controlled by the powerful Roman Empire, ruled by Caesar Augustus. He needed more people to pay money to the government in taxes, so he ordered everybody to go back to where they came from so that they could be registered for tax. As Joseph was descended from King David and came from Bethlehem, that was where he had to go. He took Mary with him. It was a long journey, and when Mary and Joseph got to Bethlehem, they found that there was nowhere for them to stay. The only place they could find was a room where animals were kept. This was where Jesus was born, and Mary and Joseph wrapped him up and put him in a cattle trough. How very strange that when the king who will rule forever came to earth, he was born in such a poor little place. Bethlehem was a village in the countryside surrounded by fields where shepherds were looking after their flocks of sheep. That night, an angel appeared to the shepherds in a dazzling blaze of light. They were terrified. The angel told them not to be afraid. I am bringing you good news, he said. The one who will save the world, the baby who will become a greater king than David, has been born in Bethlehem. You will find him in a cattle trough. And with that, the night sky opened to show thousands of angels praising God. After the angels had disappeared back into heaven, the shepherds rushed off to Bethlehem to find the baby. Then they returned to their sheep, singing praises to God and telling everybody about what they had seen. The way that God told the shepherds to come to see the baby reminds us that Jesus came to earth for all of us, whether we are rich or poor. When Jesus was just a few days old, Mary and Joseph took him to the great temple in Jerusalem. To their surprise, two people at the temple realized who Jesus was. One was a very old man called Simeon. He told Mary and Joseph that the child would be a light to show God to the whole world. A wise woman called Anna recognized that the baby would grow up to be the king who would rescue God's people. The shepherds were not the only visitors to see Jesus. Far away to the east of Israel were some wise men who studied the stars. These wise men noticed an unusual star in the sky that showed them that a king had been born to the Jewish people. So they prepared precious gifts and began a long journey to try to find him. Now at this time, Israel wasn't just ruled by the Romans, but also a king called Herod. He was nasty and cruel. He was always worrying that someone would come to take his throne away from him. The wise men from the east went straight to King Herod's palace, expecting to find the baby there. When they explained why they had come, Herod became jealous that this baby might be God's king. Because he was an evil man, he pretended that he wanted to find the baby so he could pay his respects. He sent the wise men to Bethlehem with instructions to come back and tell him where the baby could be found. But he didn't want to take presents to Jesus. He just wanted to kill him. Guided by the star, the wise men found where baby Jesus was. They were delighted and, opening their treasure chests, gave him gifts of gold, sweet-smelling frankincense, and a spicy ointment called myrrh. The way that God told the wise men to come to see the baby reminds us that Jesus came to earth for everybody, wherever we come from. As the wise men were planning to return to their own country, God warned them not to go near Herod. So, without him noticing, they slipped quietly away. As they left, an angel came to Joseph and warned him that Herod was going to search for Jesus to kill him. Without waiting, Joseph took Mary and Jesus and left for Egypt, where they would be safe from Herod. Eventually, much to everyone's relief, King Herod died. Mary, Joseph, and the young Jesus returned to Nazareth, where Jesus grew up. But those who knew the story of his birth wondered what was going to happen to him. So that's how Jesus was born. The Bible also tells us why he was born. It says that Jesus was God with us. Remember how long, long ago people had turned away from God and become separated from him? Jesus was not just an ordinary baby. He was God coming to be one of us. We couldn't get back to God, so he came to be with us. Many years later, we have the Easter story when Jesus died on a cross so we could all be forgiven. And then Jesus rose from the dead and returned to heaven. Although Jesus is now in heaven, he is still God with us. God with us. God with us.
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year!
We love you!
We love you!
Thank you.
old me pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. A newborn king to see pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Our finest gifts we bring pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. To lay before a king pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Rum-pa-pum-pum, rum-pa-pum-pum. So to honor him pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. When we jump,
a birth when you move. So Holy Spirit, let your love and power break through. As we set our hearts on you, let your love and power break through. Let heaven come closer than it's ever been. Let heaven come closer than it's ever been. As you breathe out, Lord, we will breathe you in.
TSF family, my name is Katie and I'm the youth minister here at the church. Just wanted to wish you a Merry Christmas as you celebrate the King that changes our lives forever. I pray that you're able to enjoy this time and this celebration and focus it all back to Jesus.
This month, as Katie has shared with you and the kids have shared with you, we've been on Advent, and Advent's a church tradition that is basically between Thanksgiving and Christmas, where we focus in on choosing, looking at different aspects of what we get with Christ and his gift that God has given us to prepare us and give us some anticipation as we come to the Christmas season, instead of just trying to bowl through everything and all the different activities and plans, and then you wake up, next thing you know, it's Christmas Eve Eve. So I hope for those who have been joining in on that, that's something that has been part of your season, as it has been part of my season. And through that season, we have been looking at some different narratives, the Christmas narratives, not just stories, but the testimonies that come, mostly through Luke and Matthew. If you go home and you really want to dig into the Christmas narrative, that's a good place to start, either one of those two books. But tonight I'm going to start with another gospel that hits it from just a little bit of a different standpoint. But that said, I want to go ahead and start out with a word of prayer. So will you guys join me once again? Oh, dearly Father, I just pray that you slow us down from the celebration, Father, from the activity, from laughing with the kids, from the music, Father, and just help us to step into this moment. Father, as we come, our intention, our desire is to experience something as your spirit moves, as your spirit speaks. Not with a huge study, not with a bunch of bullet points we've never heard before, not with some new angle of a Christmas story from the last 2,000 years, but just simply for your spirit to move and let us hear you, to enjoy it, to breathe it, to imagine, and to be in step with you. I pray this is your time, Father, and your time alone. In your name we pray. Amen. John 1 starts like this. He writes, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." Now, here's the thing with John. It's not necessarily the just telling of the narrative or telling what the witnesses have shared. It's not these different aspects that we have seen in Matthew and Luke, but John comes with kind of a poetic standpoint, kind of a metaphor standpoint into starting to talk about Jesus coming into this world. And it's kind of easy to miss, if you haven't read the rest of the chapter yet, what in the world he is talking about. When he's talking about the Word was and the Word is, and but when you look at it and you realize Word is capitalized with a W, and you go on and you read the rest of the chapter, it becomes very clear that he's using a nickname for Jesus, and he's calling him the Word. So I'm going to reread this, if you guys would indulge me and give me a little bit of grace, and replace Jesus' name where we have the nickname, and then we'll come back to why he calls him the Word. Where John tells us, "In the beginning was Jesus, and Jesus was with God, and Jesus was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Jesus, and without Jesus was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." Now, here's the reason why I kind of bring this into our conversation tonight is because I think when we get to looking at Christmas, and again, a lot of our background is going to be the Hallmark cards or the Hallmark movies. Or Hallmark does a lot, don't they? Or the different traditions that we've had in our past. But as we've got into week one and we talked about hope, we talked about 2020, we talked about the anxiety, we talked about the depression, we talked about the anger, we talked about the challenges, we talked about the stressors, we talked about the politics, we talked about the racism, and many more things, but I'm out of breath now. But we compared that to what was going on in Jesus' community at the time and all the challenges they had and how Jesus is the solution for them, he's the solution for us, and how he is the victory for all. And so one of the things that I think is good as we continue into this study and we get ready to celebrate is realize that Jesus is not about 33 years. And Jesus isn't just about Christmas, but that Jesus is about all. That Jesus always was, Jesus always will be, that Jesus is God. And I was looking back at some of my notes, and about 3 years ago, I did an illustration with you guys. I actually learned from my wife that she used to hear at the church talking about kids' ministry and the impact parents have in their kids' lives over the impact that the church can have. And then I know since that time, a few other people, I think Miss Audrey has used it, a couple other people do it. So I'm not original in any way, shape, or form, but I like the point that it makes. So here's basically how that illustration goes. They bring up a piece of string, and it could be a lot of different things. This looks, there's 2020. But it basically represents, there we go, we got it worked out. All we need was a vaccine. Okay, so, but it just represents all of time, right? And we've got, from the scripture standpoint, we talked about this a little bit, because the middle school and high school, we're talking about some of these things as well as we've been going through the Bible as a story. But if you go from the beginning to the end, this is kind of representing a time. I don't know when it ends, but that's the best guess I've got. And if we start, according to John, that Jesus was in the beginning, then we're looking basically just right about here for Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. Right, if we're going to start at the beginning. And again, according to John, Jesus was there. Jesus was part of the creation. Nothing was made without Jesus. It was made through Jesus. And this is when things were really good. This is when we're in the garden. We don't have to work hard. Everybody's getting along. Husband and wife are just getting along with each other. No problems whatsoever. No kids are born yet, so we don't have that stressor, right? We got all these things going on through chapter 1 and chapter 2 of how God intended for us to be with Adam and to Eve. And during this time, right before he created Adam and Eve, is when he created what? He spoke the sun into existence. He spoke light and darkness into existence. He talked, next thing you know, you got animals and you've got chihuahuas and all those type of things. And then next thing you know, he speaks and you got shrubbery and you've got hedges. You just, as he speaks, creation is coming out in those first two. It's just a beautiful time to even try to imagine. I'm a big Chronicles of Narnia fan, and I have no idea how they would ever do the first book. If you ever watch that, Magician's Nephew is all about creation. I don't know how you do that, because it's just so overwhelming, so awesome. And the thing that's cool about that, according to John, when God spoke those words, that was Jesus. That everything was created through Jesus. He is the Word. So as the Word was spoken, Jesus created. And then as we know, as we continue into, and trust me, I'm not going to go to every single chapter of the Bible. We're not going to be all night. By the way, I always just, Isaac, God bless you. This is what, year three, year four that you've been here? You always get the seat that is facing away from the stage. God bless you. It's amazing he comes back at all. All the girls giggle. I don't know what that's about. Okay, so chapter three is when everything, what, falls apart. Right? Sin comes into place. This is when we have been given this opportunity to either love God or to reject God. And he did that because he didn't want to force us to love him, because that's not love, right? So we have this option that we can go another way, that things could take and fall apart away from this beautiful creation that he has been put into place. Now, I'm not one, and I've said this many times, I'm not one to take and beat up Adam and Eve for that. You know, it's not like something like I blame them for all time because they messed up. Because as I know, as I stand here, if they didn't mess up and no one else messed up, and we've been living here for generation after generation after these thousands of years, I would have been the idiot that took and ate from that tree. You know, I'm that rebellious. And if it wasn't me, I know it was you. We're going to have some kind of race. But because we have that rebellion in us. And when they sinned, it created what? A separation. And with that separation came heartache, not just for us, but for God. When we see him come into the garden, it's not just like, oh gosh, I wish you guys, it was just brokenhearted. This is not what I wanted for you. This is not what I created for you. This is the repercussions of that sin that comes into place. And at that time, one of the most beautiful things that God did, even with his justice, is he created clothing for them to cover their nakedness, because for the first time they were naked and they were ashamed. And we don't know exactly how that was created, me personally, and a lot of different, I know I've heard different scholars speak on this, or different people have different beliefs on this. Just me personally, you don't have to go with me on this, but I do believe that it was lamb's clothing that was made out of a skin, out of a hide, that an animal had to be sacrificed to make his clothing, and that it was the sheep clothing that covered their nakedness, covered their sin, and it was the first foreshadowing we had of Jesus Christ. And when this happened, God had to create a plan. God had to create a way to give us back, an opportunity to go back. I mean, he could have just said, look, if that's what you want, that's fine, whatever. Just go. I'm going to go start on some new planet over here. But immediately he started working on the clothes that cover the nakedness, because he so desired to reconcile us back to him by him sacrificing his son. And I believe Jesus was there when that plan was hatched. I believe if Jesus was there from the beginning, Jesus is still there, Jesus is God, he knew what would have to happen, and he leaned into it. And if you read your scripture, especially if you read it like in like a short period of time, from beginning to end, in just a short amount of time, you see this beautiful love letter of God constantly trying to redeem his people, every single one. So that's the first three chapters, but as you know, there's a lot more chapters than that, and we have all kinds of history, we have all kinds of different things that happen, different teachings that we have within it. So I'm just going to go up, I'm going to say 3,500 years, okay, from a biblical aspect. I don't know what that would be, because I don't know where the end is. Okay, so let's say it's about here, about 750 years before Jesus was born. This is the time of the prophets. This is the time when God is speaking to his people through the prophets, and he's giving them word, and they're putting the word out, and they're having, we have a big section in the Old Testament of the prophets and everything that God's saying to his people and his judgments and his teachings and his commands. And within that, we have all kinds of prophecies about the coming Messiah. There's all kinds of things he tells us through them about what's going to be coming. A couple selections for you from the book of Isaiah, one of the major prophets, like Isaiah 7:14, where Isaiah said, "Therefore the Lord himself will bring you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Or Isaiah 9:6, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." These words are like so common day to most of us, especially if you're raised in the church. It's just very, very common day. But the thing that kills me is that it's written here and Jesus shows up here. It's 750 years before Jesus was born that these prophecies, over 300 of them, are given to us about the coming Messiah. For those who are looking for evidence to consider and weigh about whether or not this whole thing is real and legit, or it's just some guy made it up, the Bible, like hundreds of years ago, and everybody held on to it, they had these scriptures, these prophecies, commonly, through the synagogue, through the rabbis, through the teaching, long before Jesus came, so that they would anticipate him. And so that they would look for the solution that is to come. So we got another 350 years. We get about 400 years before Christmas, the first Christmas there, what we refer to as Christmas. And there's another period of time. About 350 years after this, it becomes the time when God gets silent. We talked about that in church not too long ago, off of the youth group lessons. About 400 years between the last page of the Old Testament and the first page of Matthew, 400 years of just silence. Doesn't mean God took a vacation, doesn't mean he wasn't active, but no more was he speaking to the prophets, no more was he giving any kind of prophecy, no more was he giving any kind of additional scripture. He just went silent. And you have to wonder what God's people thought of that. All they had now was the scripture and a promise. And many people held on to that promise, anticipating Christmas, or what we call Christmas. And many people lost their anticipation. And as I shared just a couple of weeks ago, and I think that's very similar to us today, Jesus promised he was going to come, and they lost their anticipation because it hadn't happened for a long time. I mean, 400 years, that's almost double how long we've been in the United States, right? And they lost their anticipation. They weren't looking anymore. But some were. In the same way, Jesus is coming again. It's a promise. It's been prophesied. We've seen signs. We know there's more signs to come, right? But most of us don't live any given day with more than maybe even a couple seconds of actually anticipating that Jesus is going to come back. That's how they were feeling when it came to Christmas. So it's just important to me that we put it in the broad spectrum, because Jesus didn't just show up oohing and on and did some cool things for 33 years. He always was, always is. He's all through the Old Testament. There's actually a Bible called the Jesus Bible that you can grab. Shows you where Jesus is active throughout the Old Testament as well as the New. But this is part of his big plan to rescue you. So with that in mind, John 1, 14 and 16 says this: "The Word, Jesus, became flesh, and he dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace, full of truth. For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace." One of the traditions we do have here, and the Holy Spirit can speak into it anytime he wants to and change things up, but several years ago, I was talking to Katie about this earlier today. It just was put on my heart that on Christmas Eve Eve, I really want to focus into the Christmas narrative in a way that is almost like if you had a tradition of going to Grandpa's house and he told you the Christmas story. Now, obviously, I'm far too young to be Grandpa. But I do now have two grandchildren since I started that thought process that's been in the back of my head. And I did not feel called to pull away from it. I just heard a gentleman named Chip Ingram, some of you guys might follow some of his studies, he was just talking about in one of his podcasts a couple nights ago about how sometimes we just need to stop and not try to come up with something new, not try to come up with some kind of creative right bench or left bench or whatever the case may be, but just to enjoy. So let's enjoy this beautiful, beautiful truth that came to this earth for us. Now, during this time, as you can see, this year, TSF Youth has been a big part of our Advent. And I want to say, just first and foremost, our kids have really stretched themselves, really stretched themselves. To see some of the kids up here playing drums, that their first response was like, yeah, that's like, rrr. I kind of got out of that. We have several who don't like to read scripture. They've been reading scripture to you, including a man that's about to go first up on the screens for you. We have had several who might not necessarily like being up on stage, but has gotten up here a couple times, gotten outside of their comfort zones. They've been awesome, just awesome. So I asked them to help me with some of the scriptures. Usually, if you're here on a Sunday morning, we just open the Bible and go. But tonight's more of a message, and it is a study. So I had to ask their help to share some of the scriptures with us. This is the second time I've done this. I did this about 4 or 5 years ago when I actually asked the kids to be the ones reading the scripture. This time at the time, well, let's give TSF Youth a chance. The funny thing is, out of the 4 kids that read 4 years ago, one has now moved on, and 3 are still with us. And one of our, I want to call Ben new, but he's not new. He used to come here when he was a kid, and then we didn't see him for a while. His life took him away, and then Ben back. And so Ben took that spot, and then Emily and Viv and Bryce are the other 3 kids that are still with us that are now youth for Bryce, a young adult that are sharing with us. So I kind of like seeing this come full circle. But with that, I'll shut up for a second and let Ben give us some scripture.
In the 6th month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man who was named Joseph in the house of David. And the virgin his name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you."
Ben is one doesn't like to read in front of people, and I think that's his 3rd time reading during this Advent season. You've been the bomb, man. You've been doing a really, really good job. Thank you for sharing that with us. Yeah, seriously, these guys are stretched, and they're doing really well. So let's consider this from a little bit more of a realistic standpoint. And I know we've talked about some of these things as we've gone through our studies the last 4 weeks, some of these things we haven't. I'm just going to let that all go, so I'm not going the whole time. As we talked about 3 weeks ago, as we talked about 2 weeks ago, we're just going to start from scratch about Mary. Mary being a young lady, if you can kind of just stop and pitch this a little bit, because I think we make it a little bit too, again, hallmarky. A young lady, Jewish girl, somewhere between the ages of 12 and 17, more than likely somewhere in the area of 14. She is engaged, and engagement works a little bit different back then than it does now. If you were engaged, you were basically married, except for you were not living together and you were not allowed to be intimate with each other. It was a time of preparation, as she was learning to how to be a mom, how to be a wife, how to take care of a household. She would have basic education of the scriptures, but nowhere near like the men that were around. She wasn't schooled. Her life was to carry on what her mom had been doing. And as these plans were being made for her, as she was making the plans herself, as everything was finally starting to make sense, and she's kind of gearing up what the next several decades is going to look like for her, an angel appears. I don't know about you, but that really upsets the day. That's different, especially when God has been quiet for 400 years. And he appears to you and says, "Don't be afraid. I've got good news. You have found favor in the eyes of God. That promised Messiah that you heard about in Isaiah, he's coming, and now is the time of the Lord's child." And you are going to be its mama. You are the one that's going to birth the Christ. How do you process that? When we have a young lady, a gentleman, they have a child young in these teenage years, there's a lot to consider, there's a lot to figure out, there's a lot of challenges that come with it. But if you go back those 2,000 years, we're talking crippling. We're talking all of those plans destroyed. We're talking about a fiance leaving her because he knows he hasn't been with her. And what is everybody else going to think? What's my parents going to think? What happens to all these plans? This is a time when Joseph not only could just leave her, but he could have her stoned to death for having an affair and bringing an illegitimate child into this world. She has no idea how he's going to respond. I can't imagine, and I've been a pastor now and in ministry now for over 30 years, and I've gone through my share of tough days, and I've listened to tough days over tough days from people that are going through challenges that God's been gracious enough to let us partner with. I cannot imagine anything more upheaval than this, nothing more overwhelming than Mary, who's a kid. I broke my own rule, as we said a few weeks ago, when we were studying Mary. She did have an uncle who was a faithful man. He was of the lineage of the priest. His wife was also the lineage of the priest. He was a high-ranking priest. He had an angel visit him, said, "You're going to have a child. It's going to be the forerunner." Another prophecy being fulfilled as John the Baptist was going to come into this world. And he was finally going to have a son when he hasn't been able to have a son ever, and they're in their old age. I get that, how that could be troubling. I get how that would be weird. I get how you try to get your mind around that. But he's got experience, he's got age, he's got faith, he's got education. And he said, "How is this even possible?" And the angel said, "Oh, not the right answer. Not the right answer." But this young girl said, "How is this going to play out? I'm a virgin. I'm all in. If this is what God wants, may it be to me the way that he wills it to be. But can you just explain to me how this works out? Because this does not match up with anything a mom told me about." What an incredible, incredible young lady this is. But nonetheless, young, peasant, poor, and her whole life's upside down right now. Then on top of that, again, I love the story as we go into Joseph, because Joseph easily could have skipped out. Joseph easily could have gotten out of it. Like I said, there's all kinds of options available to him. But what we find about Joseph is he decides he's going to divorce her quietly. He feels that she's already gone through enough pain because of this mistake that she has made. And so he's just going to write her a letter of divorce. He doesn't want to make a big deal of it. He doesn't want to cause her any more pain. In other words, Joseph wholeheartedly believes she had an affair. And he's devastated. And then an angel shows up. First time that he knows of it in over 400 years, except for her taking it coming up with some weird excuse not to get in trouble with him, with everybody else. He says, "Joseph, don't do this. You're going to be the Messiah's stepdaddy." Guys, I have two kids, both through adoption. When it came to Emily, I was thinking today when I was kind of just going through our study and whatnot, and remember when Jenny and I were there in that library room in the baby house in Kazakhstan, and they brought her in for the first time, and I held my daughter for the first time. I just remember just how inside everything was just, "Thank you, God, for choosing me. Thank you, God, for choosing my wife. Thank you, God, for choosing to bring us our daughter this way." Can you imagine Joseph being told by an angel, "God has chosen you to be the Messiah's father here on this earth"? He would have risked everything, everything. Reputation, standing, position, to stay with Mary. At best, it was an admission that him and her had marital relations before they were married. At worst, everybody thought he was an idiot for taking a bride who cheated on him. But God called him, and he said yes. and I began at that path. Let's go with my daughter.
In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered, and all went out to be registered, each from his own town. And Joseph also went from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judah, to the city of David, which is also called Bethlehem, because he was of the house of the line of David, to be registered with Mary, his fiancée, who was with the child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
Thank you, baby. So this gets crazier. To be able to have a census called in on things, the kid can have to go on a massive trip when you're 9 months pregnant to go to get registered because the government says they need to count everybody. You need to go back to your hometowns. That's fun. That's always good. We like when the government gets involved in our lives, don't we? Especially when they ask us to do something that doesn't make any sense to us. But nonetheless, if you're 9 months pregnant, you jump on a donkey and your fiance leads you on a very bumpy ride over all kinds of funky little roads to be able to go to Bethlehem, probably the most crowded city at this time that there was on the earth, as it was the town of David. Again, another prophecy that's fulfilled. The prophecy said that the Messiah would be of the lineage of David, which comes through Joseph. And so they go, and they go into the town, and I want you to just imagine this scene with you believing and knowing that you are going to be the mother and father of Messiah, and he's about to be born. And you go into this town, and you go from hotel to hotel to hotel to hotel, and there's nothing. Nothing. Now, I've been on some road trips, and I'm a planner. I like to plan everything out before we go. Jenny can testify to that night and day. And I remember one time we decided just to wing it. And I remember driving to three different hotels at about 1 o'clock in the morning to find out prices and to find out if they had rooms open. And I'm telling you, I was not in a good mood. I like Expedia. I like AAA. It works out well for me. I can't imagine a 9-month pregnant woman trying to find a place to deliver a child, and there's nothing except for bones. One guy says, you can stay in my barn. And that's where she had the Messiah. Now, this is another thing I think we hallmark up a little bit too much. A barn, a hay trough. We just got a new puppy. Some of you guys have been watching that on Facebook. We got a new puppy, and you know I'm not a dog person, but this one's not doing too bad. We've had him now for, I think, a whopping 4 or 5 days. I think we got him Saturday. And he's really not that bad, all things considered, but he's a puppy, and we're still having to do the housebroken thing. Thrills me to no end. And one day, I think it was, just a day or two ago, Emily was home for school online, and she wanted to take a shower, and this puppy is on her 24/7, so she asked me to watch the dog while she takes a shower. So she's attached to this thing. This thing's attached to her. It's barking, it's whining, it's everything else. I take it outside, thinking, okay, maybe I have to go to the bathroom. Nothing, not doing anything at all. Okay, bring it back in. And as soon as we get back inside, that thing goes in the living room, looks at me, and no, doesn't pee. Now, this is not the story you thought you'd get on Christmas Eve, is it? So now I'm thrilled and cleaning up. I mean, it's a puppy. It's not that big of a deal. It's just a couple of little, whatever. I can hold this thing right about here. It's fine. The stench. Isaac knows what I'm talking about. The stench was overwhelming, okay, of that puppy. Tell me we don't hallmark up them being in a barn, having a baby, putting in a hay trough, no family. Her mom's not there. Her dad's not there. It's nothing like what they ever pictured. And then to be sitting there going, wait a minute, this is the Messiah. This is the Son of God. This is the King. What did we do wrong? How did we mess this up? I think would have to be overwhelming as well. And I think when we understand that backdrop better, we start understanding the glory a little bit better. Let's see what Viv has.
And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger."
Awesome. Thanks, Viv. And again, Viv singing up here tonight, too. Man, these guys have been doing great. So the shepherds. I like the shepherds almost as much as I like the wise men, but we'll get there. The shepherds. And I've always shared with our fellowshipers, I really like, something just stood out to me different about it being night. Because if it's day and the angel showed up, you don't get the fullness of the glory, right? It has to be night. It gets that backdrop. And that makes so much sense to me with some of the stuff that we go through in life, that it's always against that darkness that we see the glory the most. But anyways, here's these shepherd guys, and we've talked about them a little bit as far as shepherds during this time, just to do the short version of this. It's considered a spit job. It's you don't want your daughter marrying a shepherd at this time. It was something that was looked down upon at the time. It was people who could not testify in court because shepherds were considered untrustworthy because they tended to let their flocks go on other people's land to eat when they were not supposed to, and they would also occasionally steal from each other when it comes to other livestock. So they weren't allowed to have any testimony, any witness whatsoever. And then to make things even better, we've got the night shift. We don't have the guys who've been doing this for a long time. We don't have the guys that own the sheep. We've got the guys who everybody else looked at and said, "Look, if you can just stay out here until 6 a.m. and make sure one doesn't get eaten, that's all we're asking. That's all we need." This is not cream of the crop shepherds in a bad place as it is. It's just those guys. Just don't fall asleep. Don't let one get eaten. Don't let one run away. And so when you have them sitting there, and we know that their education spiritually is going to be somewhat weak because they're not a Pharisee, they're not a Sadducee, they flunked out of VBS, and so they have a menial job. But nonetheless, the angel comes to them. "Do not be afraid. Do not fear. I bring you good news that will bring great joy for all the people, every single one of them." And then as they're watching this, again, remember, 400 Jews, nothing. 400 Jews, nothing. And he comes to them. And so then all of a sudden, as we were just reading just a little bit ago, that it was filled with the armies of God. That it was just, it wasn't like five more angels showed up like we see on cards. It was filled, and it was overwhelming, and it was like daylight as they worshiped and said, "This is the Messiah is here, and this is how you're going to find him. All you have to do is go into town, and you're going to find him in a hay trough and a barn wrapped in swaddling clothes. Go." And this is at the point, if it was me, that I'm wondering, okay, did I just see what I saw? Or did we have some kind of mass hallucination, which we know is impossible today, but they wouldn't know that. But like, did they seriously just say the Messiah is here? We just saw angels, the Messiah is here, and he's in a barn. Well, there's one way to find out. So they go in faith. And you know it's faith because they lost their job over that. It was over. And they go into town, and I wonder how many barns they look in before they find what the angels told them about. Because the first one probably didn't work out too well, and the second one probably didn't work out, and sooner or later, you know you got to be going, "What is going on? Do you think we're nuts?" But can you imagine what it was like when they walked around that fourth barn, or fifth barn, sixth barn, and they looked inside, and there was Mary, and Joseph, and a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, in a manger. Everything changes. Everything changes. What confirmation, what beautiful confirmation. And they fall and they worship. This must be great for Mary and Joseph when they're thinking, what did we do wrong? Where did we go off track? And then shepherds come in and say, "This is the Messiah. I worship the Messiah." Chris, if you'll give us Bryce.
"Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of the Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him.' When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. and assembling all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "At Bethlehem of Judea, for it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel.'"
I have to fulfill a promise when it comes to the wise men from a couple weeks ago. As we talked about them, I said there's certain details within that I kind of wanted to save for tonight. So I kind of screwed over. Now, if you've been here for a long time and you hear me go on and on about these things, you already know these details. But the biggest thing about the wise men is, why were they there? That's the biggest thing. They were not there the night of the nativity. They came a year or two later. There was a journey involved. When we see them come to the house that Mary and Joseph are in, and they see the child, not the baby, there's a reason for some of those. Now, if you have them on your nativity, don't go home and throw them out. That's fine. It's great. It's all tradition. Go for it. But that's still not even the weird part. The weird part is the Magi. Again, we don't know if there was two or three or four or five. We just know it was men, so we know it's more than one. Are insane to be part of this situation. Just as the saying is taken in the angels, bringing the witness of Jesus and giving it to shepherds to tell the world about it, who can't even testify in court, these guys are Gentiles. They are not Israelites. They are not of the Jewish nation. They are from far away. And we talked about, why would they be anticipating the Jesus coming when those in Jerusalem were not? And the reason comes back when we go back to the prophets. We go through a book of the Bible. It's called Daniel. And Daniel and the people of God have been taken under captivity. And Daniel, through God's grace and God's revealing dreams through him and how to interpret dreams through him, he has been raised up to a high position. And through all of this, he becomes in charge over all of the Egyptian magi. Now, magi, up to this point, practice the black arts. They were nothing to do with God. The second part of Daniel, what you find, is God revealing prophecies to him about coming days, the end days, and the Messiah. So with Daniel now being in charge, again, 700, 800 years before the Messiah is born, he's teaching the Magi, this is who God is, this is the promises of God, this is what he's telling me to look for. And Magi, being not just magicians, but also astrologers, understood the signs that they were looking for in the sky. Now, a lot of us were geeking out. Well, we tried to geek out, and then, you know, because of the Christmas star, and then it's all clouds. But a lot of people all over the world were geeking out about that. I saw a little bit last night. I think I was right. I think it was the Christmas star. I don't know what you guys saw and what I did see. But these guys, they've been looking for it for hundreds of years. Every night, from generation to generation. Is this the night? Is that the star? No, that's not the star. We're looking for this. Okay. For generations, passing it on from one to the other until one night, that elusive star appeared in the sky, and they started their journey. The reason why Gentile kingmakers were interested is because God revealed to them the same promises that he did his people. They just held on to them. So when they come into the city and they're looking, what do we find within the scripture? The scripture says they come in and say, "We are here to celebrate the Messiah. We saw the star. We know he's here. We know that the king is born. You guys must be going crazy. We want to be part of this." And everybody goes, "We have no idea what he's talking about." The king, Herod, what are they talking about? He had to get his officials to come to him and say, "Well, you know, those books that were written 750 years ago, this is what it says about the Messiah, this is who he's going to be born, this is how it's going to be, and he's going to be the leader of the people." And Herod, being a corrupt king, said, "Oh, I'm threatened. I like being in power. I like being in charge." And so he said to the wise men, "Go find this kid, man. I want to worship with you guys." But what his thought was, "Go find him so I can have him killed." And we've seen that Herod had his fair share of deaths under his belt. As the wise men go out, they move into, they find the home, the star stops over it, they go inside, and there is the child again, a couple years in. And Mary and Joseph open up the door, and these kingmakers come in with gifts, and they fall on their knees, and they worship him. Gold and frankincense and more. Gifts for a king to the toddler. Gold, a thing of great worth. Frankincense, which is an incense. and myrrh, which is an anointing oil, gold, which is, again, royalty, incense, as God breathes in our prayers, showing that he is a deity, and the myrrh being anointed not just for his mission, but is commonly used in his death, knowing what his ultimate goal here was to take the cross and be victorious again. I don't know about you, I love the Christmas narrative. It fits into a scheme of thousands of years that changes every life. But it's moments like these that we have to personalize a little bit, go, what does that mean to me? For Mary, it was, I'm young, I'm naive, I'm not educated. But instead she said, I'm all in. You are never too young, you are never too old to follow Jesus Christ. You are never too young, you are never too old to be used by Jesus Christ. You will never hear me talk about TSF kids or TSF youth as the future of our church because they are part of our now. You will never hear me say to seniors, well, this is the final years, you just sit around the house and watch Netflix. If you're here, baby, God's got a purpose for you. All he's calling us to do is to say yes and to follow him. For some of us, we might be more in the Joseph boat. But what are people going to say? What does that mean to my reputation? What does that mean if I lose this person out of my life? Joseph fully gets it. But he said yes to the Messiah because God had a plan for his life, something he was created for, something more than what we give ourselves sometimes. Or maybe you feel like you're at the bottom of the food chain, man, socially. Don't have a lot of friends, feel lonely a lot of times. Feel like maybe because of a couple, you know, past mistakes, or that you always kind of make the wrong call sometimes, that you're in the night shift of things. That's just when it's dark so you can see the glory the most. That's the kind of heart that Jesus is looking for. That's the kind of heart that God said, these are the guys that need to take his message out. These are the guys that will run around town looking like goofballs, going from barn to find my Messiah. I love these guys. Maybe like the Magi, who could forever say, how could we be part of the story? We practice the black arts. We worship deity that is not of the true God. But they said, no, the message of Jesus has come to me. There's no such thing as messing up so much that I can't have the fullness of what Jesus has for me. What do you do with it? The scripture tells us that if you acknowledge with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, in other words, you're God, I'm not. If you get to that point, and it says if you believe in your heart that he died and rose again, in other words, I don't deserve what you have for me, but I accept your forgiveness because I need it so badly, and I'm going to follow you. I'm not going to keep trying to do it my own way. I'm not going to do it by my own expectations of what this life's supposed to be like. I'm not going to keep trying to do it by my own direction because it seems to just keep running into a wall. I need you, God, and this life is yours because you created it and it should go back to the Creator instead of what I have been doing with this. I need you for my marriage. I need you for my kids. I need you for my parents. I need you for school. I need you for work. I need you when I get up. I need you when I lay down. Jesus. Jesus.
Merry Christmas, Happy New Year. Cannot wait to see what 2023 brings you. Take care, be safe, and can't wait till we're all together again.
When it comes to this season, I'm reminded of the past. Over 300 messianic prophecies came to pass. With the birth of a child, both God and man, our deliverer of sin, born with a battle plan. Sin waged war on our lives since the day of our birth. But now the deliverer, our rescuer, has come to break that curse. That which has separated us from the Father on this earth is about to be defeated by the coming of our King and Lord. Oh Mary, did you know?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters. Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child
that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. He made an appeal to the Father, our judge, by his death on our behalf. Satan never anticipated the aftermath. The chains are broken, the captives are set free. The oppressed and depressed can lift their heads, cause we are free indeed. Our redemption sealed by the blood through the sacrifice of the one born to die, so that you and I can find the life he died for, to ensure forevermore the cure for death. Oh Mary, did you know?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand? Did you know?
It is finished, my debt is paid in full. Can I ever fully grasp what it took to save this soul? But I will lift my head and I will bear my cross. I've been sanctified by the blood so Satan can count his loss. The victory's mine by birthright, reborn in his name. Authority over evil because of the price that he paid. I see the heavens open wide and seated at the right hand of God is the one and only Son, the rescuer of the world, seating in glory and authority. Oh Mary, did you know?
The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again.
Oh Mary, did you know?
The lame will leap, the dumb will speak,
the
praises of the Lamb.
Oh Mary, did you know?
That your baby boy is heaven perfect land.
Beginning and the end. He is our friend, our savior. He is Emmanuel, God with us, the King of kings and Lord of lords. He is our father, and he's here to rescue us.